Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Five Questions. I'm Sarah Downey, and I'm the president and CEO of the Michael Garron Hospital. And I'm pleased to have back with me today Dr. Jeff Powis, who's the medical director of infection prevention and control at Michael Garron Hospital and also an infectious diseases physician. So welcome back, Dr. Powis.
Thanks, Sarah.
So the topic of today's discussion is the vaccine. And the COVID vaccine, obviously. And so I was hoping you'd be able to answer some questions about this vaccine for us today, ones I know are being asked across our organization and across our community. Mm-hmm. So let me start with, what do we know? What do you know about the Pfizer vaccine and how does it work?
Yeah, so it's a good question because people are worried about how quickly it was developed and the technology being used. And so I want to just walk people through how it works. I think that will help them understand why I feel it is a safe vaccine and a great hope for us. So our immune system makes antibodies to things to protect us. And the main thing that we make antibodies to when we have an infection from COVID is something called the spike protein on the outside of the virus. And so the traditional vaccine, like the flu vaccine, what it does is it takes little pieces of that protein, this, you know, we'll say the spike protein on COVID, and injects that into us. Our body sees that protein and makes an antibody to it that then is long-lasting and protects us. This vaccine, what it does is it has something in it called mRNA. Our body uses mRNA to teach our ribosomes, which are the machines in our body to make proteins, which protein to make. What is it going to look like? And so what this does is it gives the blueprints to our body to make the protein that our antibody can respond to. So it's another way of providing that protein to our body so we can make immunity to it. It just uses a different mechanism. And the reason the mRNA vaccines are first is because when we get the sequence of a virus, which was done within weeks of this being detected in China, they can work backwards from that to see what the code is to make that spike protein. And that's why these vaccines were the first on the market, because they were the ones that were able to get to the code the quickest.
And can you tell me what the difference is between the Pfizer vaccine and the Moderna vaccine?
So they're both mRNA vaccines. They're different companies. One's a biotech in Germany, one's out of the US. They do use slightly different amounts of mRNA in their vaccine doses. One is 100 micrograms, one is 30 micrograms. The Pfizer is every 21 days apart. The other one is every 28 days. The Pfizer has been Health Canada approved. Moderna is not yet Health Canada approved. And we're still waiting for the final publication from the Moderna to be able to really review it with respect to its adverse event profile compared to the Pfizer. Although based on the mechanism of action and the non-medicinal ingredients in the two vaccines, they're going to work in a very similar way and have a very similar side effect profile. I think we have the Pfizer first. It requires minus 70 freezing, which is a little bit of a challenge operationally, but we're working through that. The Moderna is going to be a little bit more stable to transport. And so what do I think? I think the Pfizer we're going to be using, to be honest, here in our hospital for staff who can come more easily. And the Moderna will probably be used for residents who have mobility issues in long-term care where we can bring it to them more easily.
And so tell me, how on earth did these get developed so quickly?
Yeah, so I think there's several things that have led to the rapidity of the vaccine development. The first is our capacity to do molecular studies so incredibly quickly. And the fact that the genomic sequence of the virus was shared across the world extremely early. If you look at when they started the clinical trials for the Pfizer product, they started them as early as March. Like they started these almost immediately before we even had a case, I believe, in Canada. They were already doing clinical trials on these vaccines. And so it was because of this incredible power with molecular science that we were able to see the code, know what the instructions were for our body to make the spike protein with this mRNA, and then the knowledge about how to get that to our ribosomes to make the protein that allowed us to move so quickly. often the way normal vaccines, like the flu vaccine, is you have to test a whole bunch of different candidates to find which one our immune system responds to. This they knew already based on the genomic sequence. That's why it was done so quickly. The other thing too is that, you know, with a One Health concept, it's amazing what you can do across the world when everybody's singular focus in science is to get one thing done. So I think it's those two collective things that have led to the rapidity of development.
Thanks. So I think one of the really burning questions for people is it safe to get this vaccine? And Dr. Powis, when the time comes, are you going to get it?
Yeah, so I would love to be downstairs getting it right now if I could. But based on where we've seen the most mortality in COVID, I think it makes sense for us to offer it to our long-term care home partner staff first. But I would be first in line if I could. I believe this is safe. There's 40,000 patients in the Pfizer trial that they did include and did an excellent safety assessment. Again, the trials have been ongoing since March. We have quite a bit of data. There's also been used quite prolifically in the UK, so we're generating an increasing number of data in real-world situations. I'm comfortable getting this. When I look at the non-medicinal ingredients of this, it actually doesn't have preservative in it like some of the other vaccines that we use, like a thimisole that people have been concerned about, because it's kept at that incredibly low freezer temperature. So you don't need to worry about the same number of preservatives. So I'm excited, can't wait, and would be first in line, but I'm going to let others get it first.
So I guess then the question is, who will get it first? What are your thoughts on the priorities?
Yeah, so there has been a strategy released by the province, and we're working really closely with them. I got some pictures that brought a tear to my eye about our long-term care staff getting it as part of the UHN pilot, and I'm hoping that we will be able to start that very soon here locally. Our long-term care staff need to be the priority based on where we've seen the mortality. And what I envision is that it will be the long-term care home staff, the staff of retirement homes, other congregate settings, and acute care hospitals, and long-term care residents. Those are the real first priorities, indigenous communities as well. But for us, that won't be as large a population. And so we really want to try to hit those first priorities. We will be given some flexibility regarding that, but not very much. It's very prescriptive. And so I want everyone to appreciate that we're following what everyone else is doing when we're providing this in its priority sequence. And we don't have a lot of flexibility about whom we're giving it to when, but more so how we might organize and get everybody coordinated to get the vaccine.
So I'm gonna ask you a sixth question, cheat a little. So if for those who are lucky enough to get the vaccine first, can they just get rid of their masks, go back to normal? You know, as soon as you get the vaccine, are you safe and can life go back to normal? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, so I'll let you have a sixth question, Sarah. And there was a New York Times article I remember someone showed me about my first day post-vaccine. I don't know if anyone else read this, but this guy went out and did everything he had wanted to do, but couldn't do because of the vaccine. So after the first dose, you're not protected significantly until you get your second dose, and it's 7 days thereafter, so on day 28. But even despite that, I think what we need to consider is that the vast majority of the population will not be immunized. And as a result of that, we're all going to still be required to participate in those societal now norms of public health until we can get enough of our population vaccinated so we can make this go away and we can all have a big giant party.
And that party will be?
There's a bottle of wine up there, Sarah, that we'll use.
So until that bottle of wine is gone and we're not doing five questions anymore, keep your masks on, stay apart, and do your part to stop the spread of the virus. So with that, Dr. Powis, let me say on behalf of our entire organization and everybody in our community who has really counted on your leadership and education support, thank you. You've done yeoman's work in keeping us all safe and explaining to us the risks and how what we should do and what we should look forward to. And so on behalf of all of us, thank you. And we do all hope that you can get a bit of time off over the holidays. And I'm sure you'll be back on five questions early in the new year.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you. And with that, that's the end of five questions for probably 2020. And I look forward to seeing you all in the new year. Happy holidays, everyone, and be safe.